A very good evening to you. Thanks for joining us on the Tuesday edition of the show. It's the first one for the week. I'm Yemi Adebayo. Well, of course, tonight on the show, we spent a lot of time talking about the UEFA Champions League. Some matches will go, about six matches will be played any moment. It will start any moment from now. Two matches already concluded. There's a lot of talking points from home. We talk about it just concluded Asher Drobba Table Tennis Championship. We talk about, of course, the ITTF competition that was played. Aaron O'Codry was involved in that one. We'll also talk about the just concluded Para Powerlifting World Championship. We talk about that all for you on the show. Of course, you know that FIFA Arab World Cup is currently going on. So, of course, that will be another interesting talking point on the show tonight. We'll also listen to some managers as they prepare their teams for matches in the UEFA Champions League for tomorrow. Those not in action tonight will be in action tomorrow. That's a quick summary of what we're going to be looking at on the show tonight. Let's go on for now while we wait Austin to join in. But for now, let me quickly introduce my partner in the Lagos studio. Tolulope Atobatele joins me now as we go on this trip across the money spinning world of sports. Tolu, greetings to you. Thanks for finding out time to be here.
Yeah, good evening. Yeah, me, you know, it's the ninth of the Champions League again. You know, the biggest, of course, you know, our club football, you know, tournament, you know, in the world of Champions League. So one of the COVID where we see, you know, a different club, you know, trying to, you know, confirm their superiority, you know, over others. But I think, you know, at the home front here, you know, looking at Nigeria Women Football League, of course, and some other, you know, sports federation actually, you know, doing the right thing, of course, you know. Trying to achieve, you know, what is best, of course, what best good for the, you know, for the different sports we have in the country. And Aaron O'Codry, you know, bowing out at the quarterfinal stage, you know, of course, you know, a good one for him, of course, and he should be looking forward to the next edition, you know, and improve, of course, on his performance, you know, in the next, in the subsequent editions,
yes.
Of course, and so looking at other, you know, sports in Nigeria, you know, particularly, of course, looking forward to the biggest, of course, in the continent of Africa, our World Cup, instance. So, you know, which is just a couple of weeks away for
yeah.
instance. So all these are minimum, of course, you know, we gladly, you know, climax, you know, the end, climax the year, you know, for every avid,
yes.
you know, sports lovers in the world.
That's true. All right, so let's move on the show. And just like Tolulope hinted, one of the things I didn't say in my opening is that tomorrow the Women's League will begin in Nigeria. It's worthy of note, some decisions that the board has taken to sanitize the system and also ensure that the league goes on smoothly. All right, let's start the show tonight talking about the aftermath of the Para Powerlifting Championship. We'll go to Edo State, where Governor Godwin Obaseki has received one of the athletes who made the company, made the country proud. We're talking about one of the athletes, of course, in the person of Flora Ekurede. She was received by the governor. And of course, governor also reiterated his commitment to giving support to sports, of course, and creating the enabling environment for sports to thrive in the state. Ekurede participated in javelin at the event. She narrowly missed out on setting a world record. Let's take some reactions from the event. We'll come back to discuss some more on all of this.
Like he said, the world record holder, the record I set in 2016, still standing up to today, has never been broken, not even on an ordinary competition or even, you know, for Olympic Games. So with the help Edo State gave to me towards the preparation of the Paralympic Games, my intention was to reset the record. But it happened that the weather over there affected me drastically. So, but I thank God, I still came back with the medal, the gold medal, though I did not reset my record.
Clearly, there's, like you say, ability in disability, and you've demonstrated that. And we see you as an icon, as a magnet that should attract a lot of younger people, male and female, to look inwards, look into those God-given abilities and talents, and express those talents to the best of their ability. I want to congratulate you and to assure you that the government of Edo State is very interested in you and in our athletes, in our sports men and women. We will continue to invest in sports. We will continue to build more sporting infrastructure. We will continue to provide the appropriate governance for our sporting associations. We've identified a dozen or so sports that we're going to be focusing on. Fortunately, yours is one of them.
All right, you're listening to the Governor of Edo State, Godwin Obaseki, giving assurances, making promises to strengthen sports associations, create an enabling environment. And you also listened to, of course, Kurede there, speaking of our desire to break our own world record. She came back with gold, but of course she wanted to do more, and also she talked about the weather not being favorable to her. And of course, it's all good news for Nigeria. The performance in Tbilisi, Georgia was something that will make anybody proud, and it's good to note that at the highest level, she's getting accolades and support. Tolu, let me come to you. These are the kind of things you want to see. The missing part for me is that I would have loved to see this before and after, not just after, you know. But it's good all the same. And I like the fact that you hear the governor say, look, we're going to do our best. Not just, you are just one of the, you know, your sport is one of the areas we're looking at. But not just you, we're looking at a lot of other sporting events and sports associations to support, and sporting events to give value to.
Exactly, because looking at it, you know, I also have a different, you know, view, you know, for it, because you know, when these athletes, you know, go outside to represent the country, you know, they do give their all, you know, they go with the mindset, of course, you know, of, you know, writing, of course, a history for themselves, you know, and trying to make sure, you know, they write their name on the sand of history, you know. And again, you know, looking at it from the home front here, you know, rewarding this athlete, you know, after they might have, you know, do the nation proud, you know, is a welcome development. But, you know, we have to look at our structure here. One, now, yeah, strengthen, you know, the association, you know, so, you know, the federation. Mm-hmm. Now, so, you know, we the next government, you know, continue, you know, we have to look at that critically, you understand. So it is not just, you know, about strengthening the federation. So we have to look at continuity, of which has been a problem in this country, because every government wants to do something different, you understand.
Okay.
So now, Flora Ekurede, you know, did the country very well, not just her alone. So, you know, a couple, you know, we have a lot of, you know, of course, Paralympians, right, of course, that did the country proud. So, you know, every one of them, you know, should be appreciated. And of course, as she said, you know, she wants to double her effort, you know, that, you know, now she wants gold. You know, she wants to double her effort to, you know, set a personal record, Olympic record, and a world record. But and if, you know, if we're taking care of, you know, Sansa, and, you know, supported,
she would definitely
achieve all this.
All right. I believe so. All right. It's time for Austin to join in. He's waiting in the wings. So, Austin, the floor is yours. Thanks for doing this together with me tonight.
It's not a great thing to you, hear me, and of course our viewers from all over the world. It's good to be on the show. A shout out to Edo State government for, you know, supporting our Paralympians, not just the Paralympians, hear me. With the things that I've seen Edo State do for sports development, I think it's worthy of emulation. The other day, it was gymnastics we're talking about, infrastructure being built up, you know, and receiving The F54 gold medalist from the Paralympics is a testament that we want to go all the way to support sports, even at a special level, promote inclusion, and of course, give them the necessary support that we've always been talking about. So that's some heartwarming story coming right there from Benin City, the Edo State capital.
All right, that's good. So let me allow you to pick it up from that point. Let's talk about the Asoju Oba Table Tennis Championship just concluded. And very interesting, longest ever tournament, over 53 years. I mean, we've said a lot of good things about it, but I mean, just take it from there before we take some reactions. I mean, I like the part of the compliance and also the part that you have somebody winning for over, I think, 8 consecutive years.
Fantastic competition, the Asoju Oba Table Tennis Championship, the oldest, you know, competition in the country. And what a story it has been giving us, particularly with this young lady, Bose Odusoya, who is winning it, Yemi, for a record 7th time. I think we should find a way to put her name in the middle of the competition. She has shown what it means to be consistent since 2015. And she always looks forward to this competition and goes on to actually dominate. So this is a good one for talent discovery and development in the country. We're talking about table tennis, and I just hope that we'll find a way to get these players who come out of this competition to get into, you know, the national team, start doing bigger things for the country. I know we've seen quite a number of players come out of this competition and get into the national team, but we should start thinking about ways that we should find out what Bose Odusoya is doing for our table tennis, like making us so dominant, you know, at a competition, and find ways to, you know, get other young female table tennis players to do just the same thing, you know, that she's doing.
All right. So that would be good. Pictures on your screen, pictures from the just concluded Asoju Oba Table Tennis Championship. Austin, I think it's also fair that we listen to some of the players and also some of the administrators as well.
I know it's as a result of hard work. Because though I'm looking forward to play very better and also to represent my country in continental and also in worldwide.
I'm so happy for winning this competition, but it's not by my grace, but by God and by training, because I've been training hard for this competition, so I thank God for winning this tournament. I'm so excited. It's God and training. I believe it's God and training, because whenever I want to play this competition, I always train hard. I always pray to God. So I believe it's God and training and my hard work.
Well, very happy that, again, in spite of the challenges of COVID and all, we're able to hold the competition. You know, that's the most important thing, that every year the competition keeps going. There's never a year that we want to stop this competition from happening. No doubt. I mean, I was here yesterday. I saw a 10-year-old girl. She got to the semi-final. It's amazing. The talent that has come out this year, this competition will keep on being a feeder for Lagos State to discover talent in the game of table tennis. But the prayer is that by next year, the issues with COVID will be, by the grace of God, behind all of us, and we can competition in the same glamour that we have always had. So we're trying to manage the situation, not expose anybody to unnecessary risk. Even with the global situation, we have seen that it doesn't
All right, Austin. Of course, some of the guys you already talked about, Roman Akombi, Bose Odusoya, and of course the host, very elated in his speech, talking about the fact that for the past 53 years, we've always had this event on the calendar, even in spite of the unique challenges that COVID-19 prevented. They still found a way to host this tournament without risking the life of anybody. Talking about the 10-year-old that got to the semifinal, talk about some of the talents that this tournament has produced. And I think that also goes along with what you have said about all the guys, all the people we're seeing coming out of this tournament. Bosse Odisanya, everyone that can be national champions, those ones. But what about the other ones? There should be something that ensures that we keep them in the game, and who knows what they can achieve for Nigeria in years to come.
That's where the Federation and the Ministry comes in, Yemi, because that's what we talk about, structure. Shout out to Deji and his family for keeping this legacy alive, you know, and their dad will be smiling because he loved table tennis. He loved this competition when he was here with us. So they've done their part. It is up to the Federation. I know the Federation, they follow this competition keenly. They look forward to it also. So they just need to find a way. For instance, look at what we said about Bosse Odisanya, winning it for a record seventh time. Rivon Akoni is winning for a second time. You know, I think he lost the title last year and he's just getting it back again. And remember, he won the last competition we had in Lagos. So it was a good platform for him to keep his consistency going. That's what we're talking about. If you give them competitions, it will help them and they'll find a way to keep getting better with the craft. So, it's all about structure. You know, we must find a way that it shouldn't just be about competitions. After the competition, what's next? Before the competition, what are you doing? What do we have in place in terms of, you know, keeping the skills of this young person is going? Right after this competition, that's what the Federation should jump into. Rewan said it, that look, he's happy, he has won this, he wants to go continental, he wants to go worldwide, represent the country. They have a good role model in Aaron Okwadri. So we must find a way to put these things into structure. Let's not just say, the Molade Okoya Thomas family will do their sojoba and that's it. No, sit with them, have a talk, be deliberate with your planning and find ways that you keep this, you know, fantastic work going.
Yeah, that's it. And what else can we say? Kudos to the family for keeping this going. And we hope that by the time we're having the next edition, COVID would have this kind of power over us anymore. Hopefully, a lot of the things would have cleared up and we'll be able to have more categories. There are just 9 this year that we'll be able to have more categories.
Yeah, and also get the fans back, you know, proper, because this competition gets a lot of, you know, viewership, spectators through into the indoor sports hall of the Teslim Balogun Stadium. I've covered it severally, and each time I get into the hall, it's always pumped up. The energy is fantastic. And I'm sure Tolu will agree, because this is the sort of competition we need to get table tennis to the level where we want to be in Nigeria.
Give them, you know, what they really desire as far as the sport of table tennis is concerned. You know, getting the fans back to, you know, the indoor sports hall, you know, to cheer this athlete, you know, is one area, you know, the Federation should, work on. Of course, you know, try to do everything, you know, everything humanly possible, you know, within their powers to make sure, you know, they get the fans, you know, back, you know, to where they truly belong, that is the stance, you know, getting behind our table tennis players. And because I'm looking at it, you know, it's quite, of course, impressive, you know, seeing these young athletes, you know, taking themselves to cleaners. Of course, and now, you know, I want, you know, to go continental and worldwide to represent Nigeria. And of course, you know, Bosse Odisanya winning our 7th, you know, championship, of course, is a good one. But of course, there should be a roadmap, you know, after this competition, you know, what, you know, do they want to achieve? And the organizers as well, of course, must spell out, you know, what they want to achieve in the next 10 to 15 years, you know, with these athletes, you know, that have emerged, you know, are champions, and of course, and runners up in this competition. Do they want, you know, do they want to, Do you want to see them represent at the country, at the continental level and global level, or you know they just want to end there, you know, when the championship ends? So these are the questions, you know, they should of course you know give answers to, and Nigerians are waiting, you know, to hear them speak, you know, on what they want to achieve, you know, with this competition going forward.
That's a good place to leave it. Let's go on this quick break now, supposed to now China's television. When we come back, more table tennis. Don't go anywhere. Stay with us. Welcome back, Sports Tonight, on your award-winning sports love in China's television. We'll continue with more table tennis now. This time, let's talk about the ITTF, the WTT Cup Finals that took place in Changi, Singapore. We spoke to Aaron Okwori last week, Thursday, on the show, and he told us that he just wants to represent his country in a good way. And he did in his first match when he defeated world number 8 table tennis player Jin Kun from China. It was a fantastic win for Okwori, 3-1. But in the quarterfinals against Hugo Calderano, who is ranked 4th in the world, about 25 years old, and from Brazil, Okwori lost by 3-1. And he says he's pleased with the game that he played. Let's listen to Aaron Okwori. When we come back, we'll get the thoughts of Tolu, who is right there in Lagos.
I feel so happy to be here in Singapore. It's my second time of playing in the grand final. And I'm very happy with the level of play, the organization, and satisfied with my performance. I played against a much more better player today, so it was a little bit difficult. But of course, I will go and work on the mistakes and get better later. The last time we played was like 11 years ago, and he has actually improved a lot. It's really difficult to play against him. Probably I will get better next time. I will work on the mistakes. My objective are to do much more better than this year next year. And of course, it is very important to be good ambassador for my country, club, sponsors, fans, and family. You know, to have been invited for top 16, it means a lot. So I'm very happy and satisfied. I would like to say thanks to all of them. They are one of the reasons I keep going. And of course, I'm looking forward to next year. And I'm very happy if they keep supporting me next year. I will always give my best and make them proud.
All right, Aaron Okwori, very gracious in a defeat. I mean, that's the spirit of a sportsman. And also, we could always praise him for always punching above his weight. And for him to be among the elite is something that makes a lot of us happy. Tolu, your thoughts on the giant strides Aaron Okwori is making. We didn't want it to end at the quarterfinal level. He ended, but the fact that he's even beating players ranked higher than him is something to be happy about.
You know, I always drop my hat, you know, for Aaron Okwori anytime, you know, I see him play, of course, or maybe anytime I send me a field question, you know, from journalists, you understand? So, you know, saying, you know, he played against much more better players, of course, you know, and of course, you know, the world number 4, he lost at the quarterfinal stage. You know, it's quite been a while, you know, he last played against him and said a very difficult, you know, playing course to play against him is very much improved. So, and of course, you know, for admitting that alone, you know, tells you that, yeah, of course, you know, he's been a very good ambassador, of course, you know, for this country. And so, you know, getting to this stage is by no means, you understand. So it means, you know, his hard work, of course, you know, is taking him, you know, far. And the way Aaron Okwori, of course, you know, is going, you know, I think, you know, we should be happy that we have a player like this, you know, who is giving us a very good representation, you understand. So, and of course, you know, doing that brilliantly, very well. But we should look beyond the Aaron Okwori because, you know, someday, you know, someday, of course, he will quit, you know, the sport of the tennis. Exactly. So, you know, we should, you know, fast track how to develop, you know, more Aaron Okwori, you know, to take over from him when he call it quit. But, yeah, of course, those are the areas, you know, we should be looking at now, you understand? So, but
even while we are enjoying this
exactly
moment, we should be focused
now,
on that.
And now, we have a platform where we can, you know, discover as many Aaron Okwori as possible, you know, except you don't want to look towards the direction of course. You know, we just saw Ashojuoba Cup, you know, it's been, you know, it's been ongoing for years. Now, that is one avenue where, you know, where we can, you know, discover the talents, because, you know, to be not culture to start on, you know, to take over from Haruna Kodri. You know, we should not wait till Haruna Kodri, you know, say he's retiring from the sport. Then we start running heta-sketa, looking for who to take over from him. So, but I think, you know, the Table Tennis Federation in Nigeria, of course, have a lot of work, you know, to do because, to make sure, you know, the game of table tennis, of course, takes us, you know, where we truly want to be in the committee of a world table, you know, tennis, you understand? Right. So kudos to Haruna Kodri, you know, kudos to his sponsors, kudos to everyone, of course, associated with Haruna Kodri.
Yeah, kudos to them. All right, so that's the last bit on table tennis as we move on the show tonight. Guys, let's talk about what's going to happen tomorrow. Women's football is our next port of call. In my opening, I talked about the league starting tomorrow and how happy I am with some of the things I read about the decision makers in women's football in Nigeria, swiftly taking decisions about venues not up to scratch, about teams not able to meet requirements to participate in the league. You look at all of those things, it's very heartwarming, and sometimes you hope that the guys can do that as well. All right, let's quickly show to you the fixtures before we put our thoughts on this. The fixtures of day one of the new season in women's football, and there you have it on your screen. Of course, we have Group A and Group B, match day one. Let's start with Group A. Conference Queens to take on Pelican Stars. Nigeria Retails to take on Osun Babes. Osun Babes currently have an issue. They're not going to be able to use their home ground because it wasn't up to scratch, so they'll use the nearby facilities. Adamawa Queens will take on Edo Queens. Then in Group B, you have Robo Queens take on Abia Angels. Delta Queens take on Rivers Angels. Sunshine Queens take on Bayelsa Queens. All right. I'm a bit excited ahead of the women's tournament. I don't know if Austin shares my enthusiasm based on some of the decisions that have been taken recently and the fact that they found a way to navigate problems. You know, we have a unique situation on our hands in the country. Problems will always be there, but they seem to always find a way to navigate some of these issues.
Straight up, it just tells you, yeah, I mean, once again, that women are better managers, you know? And we're not just seeing it now. It has been like this, I think, in the last 2-3 seasons, and we must commend Aisha Falode on our board for, you know, ensuring that we do the right things, that we respect standards, you know, when organizing the Football League for women. And the last time we talked about the Women's League, I think it was on the morning show, where we're talking about teams not coming out to register and not meeting the financial obligations, that I'm sure Aisha Falode and the board will ensure that they do those things that they need to do, you know, for us to get the league running on December the 8th, you know. And women's football in the last two seasons, it's been on the rise. We've seen some fantastic, you know, play. We've seen clubs, you know, showing signs that they can compete. Sunshine Queens doing good, Edo Queens doing so well, you know, but then Rivers Angels, Bayelsa Queens, Nasarawa Amazons, you know, also, you know, showing that they can control the way the league is played. But it goes beyond the play, actually. Everything, Yemi, at this stage, it is very important. If we get planning right, if we get the policies right, don't just say it, don't just put on paper, implement them. Women's football will grow, particularly now that we've got the CAF Women's Champions League going. Rivers Angels, they've gone to see that, look, it's not about winning at home. It is about making sure that you are solid enough to go compete at the continental level. That's what we're talking about. So let's just hope that when the league comes, we'll see quality football, we'll see clubs do those things that are required to, you know, call it a professional football league.
Yeah, and Tolu, without repeating everything that Austin has said, one of the advantages of what the decision makers in women's football are doing is, if the proper structure is in place, we're not going to have situations where our teams go outside and begin to have problems, not because we don't have quality players, but because we always mess it up administratively. And that's why I'm very happy. Some of the decisions were tough decisions, but they were decisions that needed to be made.
Yeah, you know, exactly, because that is where we always, of course, have our problems, you know, administrative
lapses.
Lapses, you understand? So, because when we don't get it right there, we'll never get it right. That's fast. Because football is not playing on the pitch alone. Because once you take a wrong step, you know, at the beginning, it will surely affect the whole system. Mm-hmm. So, and the player, the gladiators, you know, will be the one to suffer. You know, at the most, you know, for the wrong decision you have taken at the initial stage. Because now, looking at it, now we should be proactive enough, you know, to say this is actually what we stand, you know, to achieve at the end of the day, because women football, you know, is taking a new turn now, because you know, you can't just sit at home and say you're playing football when actually you are doing nothing, you understand? Yeah. So, and if really, you know, you want to play football, of course, you know, you have to play by the rules. You know? So you can't say this is what you want, you know, and not playing by the rules, because, you know, we know football is business. You know, it's not just about, you know, leisure alone. So it's a business, and you have in. And if you want to, if you really want to, of course, you know, make it work the way, you know, it should work.
Yeah.
Because we have to, you know, we have to be strict with ourselves. You know, we have to put every machinery in motion, you know, to make sure that we get the desired result at the end of the day. Now, looking at it, yeah, you know, continental football, of course, you know, is there, you know, for women, you know, to take part in now. So, for you to get to that level, yes, you must, of course, you know, you must perfect your, you know, your homework and work, of course, very well, you know, to get to that level. Otherwise, you just, at the end of the day, you just, I say that all the work, you know, all the work, you know, you've been all these days for a month to nothing at the end of the day, which is not supposed to be. Kudos to Aisha Falode, of course, you know, for taking, you know, women football in Nigeria to, you know, to another level, you know, setting the pace, you know, for others to follow, telling them this is how, you know, things should be done. And we, you know, we are doing it the way, of course, it is spelled out, you know. And of course, what we want to achieve, you know, matters a lot. We are not just playing football, you know, for fun. We are not playing football to run around the pitch for 90 minutes. We are playing football, you know, to make something out of it, you know, to let Nigerians know that yes, we are not there to while away the time. We are there for a serious business. You know?
All right, that's it. Proper structures and doing the right thing, especially now when we know we have a challenge with other African countries catching up. I mean, you would have thought that the first CAF Women's Champions League would be won by a Nigerian team. I mean, by virtue of how strong and dominant we are. But administratively and some other reasons, we just messed it up and we are where we are. So we have a big task on our hand. Let's move on the show because we are pressed for time. UEFA Champions League, let's give you a situation report. Let's also remind you that two matches are currently going on in the FIFA Arab Cup. We'll get to that in a bit. Let's start with the UEFA Champions League. So I give you a situation report of the UEFA Champions League. Let's start with the ones that have been concluded. We're going to give you the results. Let me just quickly reel out the results. For the ones that have been completed, Paris Saint-Germain defeated Club Brugge 4-1. You have RB Leipzig and Manchester City. That game ended 2-1. RB Leipzig won that game. It was a very much changed City side. Kyle Walker got red carded in the 83rd minute. No excuses, though. Man City lost that one. They've already qualified as group leaders. So, match is currently going on. Let's give that to you. Of course, AC Milan and Liverpool. It is one goal apiece as we speak. 36 minutes of football played in that one. Ajax and Sporting Lisbon, same situation. One goal apiece. 37 minutes of football played. Dortmund and Besiktas. Dortmund lead currently. All right. So, in that game, it's 1-1 now. AC Milan and Liverpool. Yeah, so that's it. And FC Porto and Atletico Madrid is goalless as we speak. Ajax and Sporting Lisbon, a goal apiece. Dortmund and Besiktas. Dortmund currently leading. FC Porto and Atletico Madrid is goalless. Real Madrid and internationally, Real Madrid leading currently after 37 minutes of football. They're a goal up. Shakhtar Donetsk and Sheriff Tiraspol, of course, it's goalless after 38 minutes. All right. Austin, most of these days, you're close to the scene of the action, and I mean, your thoughts basically for Liverpool, for the English teams involved tonight. They've done the business before the final day, so whatever happens, it wouldn't matter. And Jurgen Klopp actually confirmed yesterday they're going to rotate, so no surprises if things don't go the way people expect.
Yeah, but you know, it's the UEFA Champions League, and if you've got an opportunity to boss your way around, you know, win, show dominant play, it will help you when you get into the round of 16. And that's what Liverpool seem to be doing in their group. But going a goal down now against AC Milan, would definitely be a wake-up call that they need to, you know, go all the way. They already have 15 points from that group. But Manchester City and Pep Guardiola, they need to worry. I
mean, although Liverpool... Liverpool has already equalized, though.
Yeah, there you go. This is the second loss for Manchester City. Though they still top that table, but if you check it now, it's getting tight because they have 12 points. PSG with a dominant win today over Club Brugge, they have 11 points. While RB Leipzig, with that surprising victory over Manchester City, they are third on the log now with about 7 points. So look at PSG, for instance. A brace each for Lionel Messi and Kylian Mbappe. They needed to get the job done, and they did. Quintessential Lionel Messi Champions League goal. The third goal is scored for PSG. It was a classic built for TV, and PSG showed that, look, they needed to win that, and they went on to win. I know Leipzig has got some quality, and they've shown it in the UEFA Champions League in the last 2-3 seasons. But this is the sort of game expect Manchester City to win, not for anything, but for consistency, but to show that, yes, you want to go on to top that table. With the way they've lost this one now, there's no way it's not going to affect their play. And I like the fact that we've put it out there. No excuses. This City team, they've got enough players to go out there to get the job done. But, hey, it's the UEFA Champions League where you saw FC Sheriff beat Real Madrid at home, so anything can happen.
Surely anything can happen. Tolu, your thoughts of all the results, any surprises?
Of course, you know, there is Leipzig against Manchester City. You know, to be fair and honest with ourselves, nobody will have, nobody will say that Leipzig, you know, we get at it over Manchester City. You know, looking at the talents at their disposal, of course, mm-hmm. and how, you know, they play. Of course, and it's a game, you know, they actually, of course, you know, wanted to win, but unfortunately, you know, football, you know, didn't go the way they expect tonight. So they just have to, you know, take the result back to England, you know, till, you know, they come out again of their shell, you know, to meet the next team in the next stage. You know, and for Leipzig, of course, you know, they've been a brilliant team, you understand? So they don't have a superstar, you know, in their rank, but they do have a very compact team, you understand? So, you know, they attack, you know, and defend them massively, you understand? So, and the coach, of course, you know, really understand the mentality of his boys, of course. And he also always come up with a very good, you know, tactical formation, you know, that the players, you know, find very easy, you know, to execute. You know, when you see them play, you know, this is a team, you know, for the future and a team, you know, to look out for. Of course, you know, very soon, you know, they will start, you know, dominating, you know, European, of course, you know, our football circuit, because with the way they play, and of course, you know, and again, we just have to, pity Kyle Walker, you know, for mm-hmm. seeing red, you know, in the game, you know, he's actually a good player, but tonight, you know, just wasn't at the day, yeah. So you just have to, of course, accept that not every time you win a game, you win some and you lose some.
Definitely.
So that's it, more UEFA Champions League will come up tomorrow. That game, Yemi, quick update. Liverpool won, AC Milan won. Fikayo Tomori scored first for AC Milan, and then Liverpool, you know, equalized through arguably the best player in the world right now, Mo Salah. You know, you can't stop him. He's on fire. So confirmation of the result right there. There will be more games tomorrow in the UEFA Champions League. Chelsea will be busy, and let's listen to how they're getting ready for that one.
You know, we have bad news because Matteo was in training yesterday with a big smile, and it was pure pleasure to have him back. And he got tested positive today for Corona, so he's isolating and quarantining and out for another several days, which is a huge setback for him personally and for all of us. Yeah, I was aware of it, that this can happen, me personally, and I'm absolutely not happy that it's happening, not only as a manager, but as a person. But this is what reality is at the moment, and we have to face it and to be ready to adapt, to secure health and do the best thing possible.
Final group clash for Chelsea against Zenit St. Petersburg. They share the leadership of the table. They're on top. Chelsea on top of the group eight table with 12 points, followed by Juve also with 12 points. Tolu, it's Chelsea against Zenit St. Petersburg. Do they have cause to worry, knowing that they're going away to play that one?
Yeah, I think they should have a cause to worry about, because they have a depleted team right now. So I'm going to Zenit St. Petersburg. They should expect firepower, from the opponent tomorrow, knowing fully well that, Petersburg, of course, we also want to make a statement, even if at all they will lose. Of course, they will not want to, lose cheaply, to Chelsea. And of course, Chelsea being the defending champions, of course, of the Champions League, we also, try to make something out of that game. Well, they have a squad, because 11 players don't make up a squad. So if some players are out, the players, of course, are fit for the game. For them, should be able to stand up to it, and should be able, to let the coach know that for we can we can actually get this one going, in the absence of the top of the regulars. But for me, Thomas Tuchel says, they have to face it, and they have to adapt, to the situation.
That's the situation. They have to do that. All right, that's a good place to leave it on the show. I thought we were going to be able to talk about the Arab Cup. Two matches currently going on. Algeria and Egypt 1-1 as we speak. Lebanon and Sudan. Lebanon leading by a goal. But of course, those two are not going anywhere. Algeria and Egypt have already qualified. And if it ends this way, Algeria tops the group. Probably we have more time tomorrow to take a look at that. That's how we wrap things up on the show. But first, I want to thank Tolu Lopatobatele for his time on the show. Tolu, thanks for being here today.
Yeah, thank you, Yemi, for having me on the show.
All right. That's the show today. We do hope that you've enjoyed everything we've been able to do in the limited time that we have. We're going to be back here again tomorrow to do what we love doing best, taking you on the trip across the money spinning world of sports. From Lagos, here in Nigeria, I'm Yemi Adebayo, saying bye-bye now.
London, I'm Austin O'Connor. Tomorrow will be busy. Barcelona will be playing. Manchester United will also be playing the UEFA Champions League. That's more than enough reason for you to keep talking sports. Bye for now.